Composition for me actually came really early, because it gave me a way to understand the other things, the other like little black things that were on the paper. When I didn't know how to read what those were, I started to make my own language up in a way. And that's kind of what composition was. So I came in backwards. Most people don't come in composing first. But it was, and I'm not saying they were great tunes. You know, these were tunes that when I was like 5 and 6 and 7, banging on the piano. But because I couldn't read what was on the paper, and my sister was playing piano at the time, I started to compose. And it's something I still love to do, but it has become harder, you know, over the years. But it's still something I love to do. Sometimes when people ask me who are my favorite composers, it's hard to answer that because I didn't know who the composers were until later. You know, I would get these records and I would think because it was the artist, you know, I kind of pulled that right into when I started listening to jazz. Like, well, Michael Jackson had to compose that song. Little did I know it was such and such, or Greg Phillinganes, or somebody else, whatever. Or a staff writer at the label, but to me, it was a Michael Jackson song. So I can talk more about the artists who inspired me as composers, but I didn't really know who wrote the individual songs. I mean, Steely Dan was the first one where I saw, like, you know, two different parts of a song, you know, and then Ronnie Laws, everybody plays Always There, but when it goes to that bridge, like, that was like, wow, something else new can happen in a total other key, you know, or Stevie Wonder, although most of his compositions were, but it was more so the artist and how they navigated through those tunes. And then I discovered later, wow, who the great composers were that these artists were performing. There's so much I could say about Trudy Pitts and Aunt Trudy, as I called her. And it's a long history there, because without Aunt Trudy, I don't think I would really, really be playing, because she was one of the first people I really got to know musically when I got to Philadelphia with my mother. And my mother was a singer, and she pulled my mother back out to sing on Blessed Ones, The Eternal Truth, when she was doing it with the Clayton White Singers. So beyond, I don't even think I understood what she could play on the piano or the organ. I don't think I understood that. But what I did see is an amazing musician, and I wanted to be like Aunt Trudy. Then as time went on, I'm like, wow, look at this. And I started to get my love affair going on with the piano. I started to really see how deep Aunt Trudy's pianistic and organ and musical skills were. The first thing when you prepare to play, for me, any of the songs that you find in any real book or compilation and you get a chance to check out the sheet music, one of the things I didn't do that I should have done more, and I can be honest about it, is I came into it in a classical way, so I didn't use my ear as much to learn music. I would get the music first, and then I would learn it, but now I'm doing it completely opposite now, learning to just check it out and get my ears together, and then the sheet music is like an added bonus. So with all this music, whatever fake book you get, and including this book, make sure you can find the recordings and get familiar with the recordings. And I say that when you go to a tune like Anisha, I didn't know anything. I knew more about her performance with Rahsaan Roland Kirk on, I believe the record is called Other People's Music. And it was just, I remember hearing the bells, and because it was like a small orchestra and she's playing the organ. And it was just like, wow. So I fell in love with that version first. And I never even thought I would play the tune, you know, just that was it. Then years later, she did a record on a label out of Bermuda. And I don't know if you can even get it, but Anisha is actually on the cover. Her face is on the cover smelling a rose. And she plays a beautiful organ version on it, which was totally different than the Rahsaan Roland Kirk version. And then finally, on Me, Myself, and I, are solo piano, and you get to hear the journeys that she takes you on that piece. So I say all that to say, you never knew where she was gonna go with any of her compositions, and you really just buckled up and took the trip with her, and it was just amazing. It was like, okay, I heard it like this before, but now you're gonna do it like this. And she left so many opportunities in the way that she performed it. I've been working along with the Jazz Gallery out of New York in a mentoring series, and it's a great series. We brought some people down to another venue 2 years ago to South, and they performed there. And basically, they take an artist to work along with a younger artist. And the timing worked out for when I was doing the mentoring program that this performance came up. And I said, man, that's great. Because one, you're going to a 19-year-old Morgan Guerin, Roland Guerin's son, great bassist, his son, playing tenor saxophone today, Morgan. But Morgan plays piano, he plays drums, he plays bass, a great artist, and play the music of somebody he might not have been exposed to. You know, who knows if Morgan would have ever checked out Trudy Pitts if we didn't do this, because it's not one of those names that he would have been familiar with. And then also, like, she mentored me. I thought, this is great to have Morgan involved in this. And it's, you know, this is our fourth performance, actually. And it's really been fun getting to know him. And I'm glad it worked out around this time. And also working with me in the mentoring program are Madison Rast and Byron Landham in the band, and, you know, just some suggestions. But this guy has it all together. More, I mean, he's really great young student of the music, very polite young man. And I mean, oof, wait till you hear him. But anyway, that's joining me tonight. The young and the old and the young and the restless. I mean, Philadelphia was so special to me because I moved here from Trenton, and at the time thought I was gonna be, you know, I was gonna be in the movie Rad 2. That's what I wanted to do. I went to freestyle. You know, I was going crazy, getting all the bikes. I didn't really skateboard, but I was on bikes. And that's what I was going to do. But when we moved to Philadelphia, I got the opportunity to go to a new school, and I met this great music teacher. I wasn't really playing the piano, but I would mess around. And she said, you got to go to GAMP. And I went to Girard Academic Music Program, and the rest is history. So without Philly, there's no way I would even be playing this music, I think. I love my connection with Trenton, New Jersey, but I always wonder if I had stayed in Trenton, would I have continued to play music, you know? So it's all, you know, as much as I hate to say it, I'm your fault, Philly.